Welcome, everybody. We greet you in Jesus' joy, and it's good to see everybody out tonight for another time of Kingdom Academy and for a time to dive into the Word of the Lord. The Bible says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. And even as the song declared, He, our God, the Lord Jesus Christ, is still a miracle worker. He works miracles. Amen. Glory to God. He is the only one that is able to do what is impossible with men. The Bible says all things are possible with God, and it's possible to them that believe. And so we're grateful tonight. And as we prepare to start our class tonight, let's pray. Father, we just thank you. We praise you. We glorify your strong name. God, we lift up your name, the name of Jesus, the name that is above every name. You are the Most High God. Father, you are the only true and living God. And we thank you tonight and we give you praise. Thank you, Lord God, that even as you blessed us throughout this day, your word declares that from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, your name is worthy to be praised. And even as you brought us through this day faithfully, from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, Lord, we give your name glory. We pray tonight that as we utilize this medium of technology, that we might glorify your name, that we might tell of your good works, that we might share, Lord, and even declare your word tonight. Thank you that your word says wherever you find your name recorded, that you would come and you would bring a blessing. And we thank you for your blessing that resides in the midst of us, this body of believers, because we have come together in agreement. You said where two or three gather in your name in agreement, you will be in the midst. And we thank you tonight. We pray for our instructor tonight. Thank you for the anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Lord, we thank you for ears to hear. We thank you for eyes to see. We thank you for the mind of Christ to understand and to know. And we thank you for hearts that are receptive to receive you. And we give you praise in all that's said and done tonight. In Jesus' strong name, amen. Amen. Glory to God. Can we just take a moment and just put our hands together and just give God praise tonight? Hallelujah. For the Lord is good and his mercy endure forever. For the Lord is good and his mercy endure forever. Amen. And I'm getting ready to turn this class over. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I feel something stirring in the spirit. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's just something about when believers come together and we gather in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. There is something that happens. There is an exponential power that is released. There are blessings that are released. Amen. All right. All right. So tonight, our instructor is Dr. Karen McCray. And so at this time, without any further ado, I'm going to turn the class over to her that she can share with us what the Lord has given her tonight. Dr. Karen McCray.
Thank you, Apostle. Tonight, we're going to be discussing one of the disciples, the Apostle Peter. I had given you all a scripture to read. I gave you all Matthew 26, 31 through, I think, 35 was one of the scriptures that I gave you. At the end of class last week, I told you all we were going to be talking about Peter's denial of Jesus. And I had explained, I said, you could read it in any one of the four gospels because all four of the gospels give the account of Peter's denial of Jesus. And a prophetic word that Jesus gave to Peter, saying to Peter, Peter, before the cock crows three times, you're going to deny me. And it came to pass. And so I want to discuss Peter, and I wanted you to read it in advance, because as we discuss crossing over and moving forward, I wanted to look at someone in the Gospels, and we're coming to the New Testament, of someone who had to cross over. But his circumstances, wow, of him having to cross over and move forward, I do believe many of us can identify with Peter in more ways than one. Peter, this favorite, I won't say favorite, but this close disciple of Jesus. I mean, him and Jesus was really close. Peter was considered to be in Jesus's inner circle. Peter was the one, I always say Peter was rambunctious. He was outspoken. Whatever came across Peter's mind, Peter just said it. He didn't withhold anything. He had a little bit of loose lips at times, okay? Peter was the one. Jesus was walking out on the water. It was dark. Everybody else scared. Peter said, if that's you, Master, bid me come. Jesus told him to come. He walked on the water, okay? When Jesus said, who do men say that I am? They say, some are liars, some this. What did Peter say? Thou art the Christ, the Messiah. He had it. I mean, Peter would be on it. And Jesus said, you're right, Peter. Flesh and blood didn't give this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Peter was with Jesus on the mountain of transfiguration. When he transfigured up there and he turned white as I don't know what, they say like a refiner's white. Is the way Jesus was on that mountain, and the voice came down from heaven, and Peter was right there to hear the Lord say, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. This the Peter we talking about. We're talking about one who was always there on the spot. So we're talking about someone who had a relationship with Jesus. He walked with them. They slept together. They talked together. Matter of fact, Peter invited Jesus to his house. And when Peter's mother-in-law was sick, Jesus touched and healed Peter's mother-in-law. So we're not talking about someone who is a stranger to Jesus. Neither are we going to be talking about someone who just came to Jesus. We're talking about someone who was with Jesus from the beginning of his ministry all the way up to even when Jesus was crucified on the cross. All right, so we're talking about someone who, you know, how some people say, I've been walking with Jesus for 40 years. I've been walking for Jesus for 30 years. Well, Peter can attest, I was walking with Jesus from the time of his ministry to the end of his earthly ministry. Peter got this testimony. But something happened that brought a stop, another stop to his zealousness. Because, I mean, Jesus had to correct Peter sometime because Peter would come right back and say something stupid, okay? We know that. And then Jesus would have to correct Peter. Peter, you don't know what you're talking about. Just hush. You know what I mean? And like, you know, just hush. You know, you don't even know what spirit you're talking out of. So this is the kind of relationship him and Jesus had, okay? Now, would someone get me Matthew 26, 31 through 35? I would prefer you all know if you would read it out of the New King James Version or the King James Version. If you would get Matthew 26, 31 through 35, we're going to move fast, a little fast. I hope I can finish it all tonight on Peter Apostle. But let's talk about Peter and let's read this scripture aloud. Does anyone have Matthew 26, 31 through 35? Would someone read it for me?
You said 31 through 20.
Matthew 26, yes. Verses 31 through 35.
I have it.
Okay, read it.
Then Jesus said to them, all of you will be made to stumble because of me this night, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I have been raised, I will go before you to Galilee. Peter answered and said to him, even if all are made to stumble because of you, I will never be made to stumble. Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you that this night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. Peter said to him, even if I have to die with you, I will not deny you. And so said all the disciples.
Woo! Peter said, even if I gotta die, I will not deny you. Woo! Wow. Now y'all take off your Western hat. Take off your modern stuff now, and let's go back into time with Peter and understand that they were nailing people to the cross. Okay, you weren't just, they didn't have an electric chair and they wasn't giving you an injection to kill you. And whatever court found you, whatever the Romans found you guilty of, you were nailed and hung to a cross. It was a miserable, tragic death. Also, during that time, Peter and the disciples knew not only that there were rumors, but they knew that it was talked that Jesus was going to be killed. And they tried to get Jesus not to go up to Jerusalem. But Jesus had to go anyway. So when you read the account, you're going to find where they say, you know, Jesus, don't even go to raise Lazarus because they want to kill you up there. And Jesus said, I got to go anyway. And what did they say? Well, y'all, come on, let's go with them because, you know, he going to go anyway. So we may as well go with them. But now Jesus has been arrested. They came and got him out of the garden. And Peter, in one of the accounts, drew his sword and cut off one of the soldier's ears even, and Jesus put it back on. I mean, Peter was something. But then he got arrested. And what did he say? I'll die with you. But what did Peter do? Peter denied Jesus. The girl said, weren't you with him? That wasn't none of me. The other people came along and said, wait a minute, you was with him. Yes, you was. You even sound like him. No, that wasn't none of me. Some of the accounts say he was vehement with his words, as if he was literally cussing, okay? That's my third time, Peter go, it wasn't me. I don't know him. And then the cock crowed three times. So I want you to imagine that you, Peter. Mm-hmm. And you said you was going to die for him. You said all that Peter said. And I want you to imagine this. Once that cock, that rooster crowed three times, and the prophetic word of Jesus came to pass. What do you think? This, I told you, I want to have some lively discussion, and let's be honest, don't go way out there. What are some of the thoughts and emotions Peter was experiencing when that prophetic word came to pass, that he was going to stumble and deny Jesus? What do you think Peter was feeling at that time? Come on, we're talking about human emotions.
Well, Prophet, to start off, I can imagine Peter probably felt, condemned.
Okay.
Especially because after the rooster crowed, the third time, and then the prophetic word of the Lord came back to him. I'm sure when he remembered what Jesus said, he also remembered how aggressive he was, that he was not going to deny him. He was very, convinced that he was not going to deny Jesus. So I would say condemnation, felt bad or condemned about it.
Okay. Anyone else?
I was going to say maybe just disbelief. Like, I can't believe, I can't believe I've done it.
Okay, that's good. Anybody else?
He felt as though he was weak because he couldn't stand strong.
He probably felt weak because he was not strong. Okay, Sister Melinda, were you saying something?
Mm-hmm. I was just going to say I felt that he would be scared, thinking, I really did say this, but did I really mean what it was that I really just said?
Uh-huh, and being fearful. Okay, scared. Anybody else?
I think he may have felt ashamed.
Yeah, that's a good one. Come on, what are some other emotions, that feelings that may have crept in with Peter? What he experienced?
Mm-hmm. Guilt.
Yes. Uh-huh. Anything else?
Anger.
You're not wrong, because I want y'all to go here with me about all of the types of emotions that come in when you say you're going to do one thing. Come on, I know you've been like this. When you say you're going to do one thing and then you end up doing another. Come on, Evangelist Lisa.
Disappointment.
Okay.
Angry with himself.
angry with himself, yes.
Maybe felt that was one of the dumbest things I ever done in my life.
Yes. Uh-huh. I see Terry wrote, not worthy of this friendship. Anyone else? Okay, now, just thinking about all of these emotions, in what way, if any, do you think that Peter's position changed in the eyes of Jesus as well as the other brother?
I would say no, because Jesus already knew.
No. Now, I want y'all to remember, this is at the point of the denial and what he's going through. In what way, if any, does Peter believe his position with Jesus has changed, as well as his position with his other brethren in as disciples? Okay.
They felt that he was a letdown?
Okay. So Peter Fabron felt that his position changed because he let them down?
I was going to say that he probably felt that Jesus would deny him. And okay. that even mm-hmm. the other disciples would kind of disown him, you know, because he kind of, he was so loud about what he wasn't going to do. To turn around and do it, you know, he just probably felt like they would deny him, and he felt like Christ would as well.
Okay. Anybody else? Dr. Harley?
Yes, ma'am. I was gonna say I agree with Prophet. But when we speak out of our mouth, these are the words that are strong, and these are the words that either make us belong to something or not. And we have verbally said, I'm with Jesus. Now Peter is saying, I'm not with Jesus. So out of his own mouth, he changed his position with Christ.
Okay. Evangelist Lisa, you were going to say something?
Yes, I would think that he felt very far from Christ and from his brothers. Like, he's not worthy to walk with him, be around him anymore. I know, based on things I have done, I felt like I was so far out of the way, so far away from God, that there was no retribution, no restoration for me. Like, I was so far gone, so far away from him, because I left.
Okay. You all are in the right direction, because remember, I said, you got to remember how close Peter was. So he would have heard the words of Jesus and the words that Jesus spoke. Because remember, there is scriptures where Jesus said about, if you deny me before my Father, you know what? In heaven, he will what? Deny me. So all of these words are probably coming back to Peter as to say, oh no, what have I done? We're in this downward path now. Our mind is what? Spinning. And it's like, oh, wow, what does Jesus think of me now? My position now, am I in right standing with God anymore? anybody ever been like that? Evangelist Lisa has said, have you ever done something so bad like Peter that you began to question whether or not your position with Jesus has changed? Because I think all of us at some point have gotten to some places where it was like, oh, I done messed up really bad and really felt so ashamed of what you did, and you were condemning yourself. Okay? So now, with all of these thoughts and all of these things that's happening, And him seeing his position changing, do you see any point in Peter continuing in ministry at this point? Do you see now why Peter went fishing, maybe? Oh. Would you, if you were at that point, want to continue in ministry? Let's be honest. Or would you just go back to doing what? Whatever you used to do. What you were accustomed to. Come on, anybody. Give me some thoughts here.
I think I would feel ashamed, but I would feel like I would have to make it right. I have to fix it. I have to get back in right standing. But I would still have to take the time to deal with my guilt. Mm-hmm. So I would be ashamed, but I would feel like I would have to make it right.
Okay. Well, answer this question. Also, what do you think? Why do you think Peter returned to fishing? Anybody?
It was a stress reliever. Uh-huh. And it was what he was familiar with.
Okay. Anyone else?
He may have temporarily lost hope.
Come on.
He may have felt like he did not even deserve to be in ministry anymore. How's anybody going to listen to me when they've heard me deny Jesus? Who's going to listen to me now talk about Jesus? And how am I going to try to bring somebody to the person I just denied publicly and openly to so many people? I'd go fishing and go about my business, go hide under a rock.
Thank you. Understand something. What we're talking about is actually what we've been talking about in the Old Testament when they got to the sea before they could cross. There was something in between blocking them getting over into the promise. No, they didn't put the water there, but it was there. And they got to what? Cross over that water. They got to cross over that water. Peter now is dealing with his side of the Jordan and all of the things that he has done. That water now is kind of like his thing that his denial is something that's blocking him from moving forward. Wow. It's blocking him from crossing over. All of us at some point have had something. This is his warfare based on his own mouth, his own actions. And at point in time, there are times we say something, we do some things, even though we've been walking with the Lord. We can say something, we can do something that can cause us to get to a point where we want to stop because we are so condemned, feel ashamed, we don't want to appear as hypocrites. All of these thoughts and emotions, we're feeling guilty, we're feeling bad, and we're saying, how can I go on talking about being a minister or being a disciple and representing Christ and look at what I've said or done? And so we could get to a point where we get like Peter and we go back to what we're familiar with. We go back to, okay, well, I know how to fish. He said he was going to make me fisherman men, but I can't see where I'm going to be fisherman men based on the decision I made. So I'm going to go back to fishing for real fish, my livelihood. Because you got to understand, he was not fishing for his fish anymore. He was walking with Jesus in ministry. So now he said, I'm going to give up this ministry and go back to fishing. How in the world can I represent what I have denied? Not only that, I'm scared. Are Are you hearing where we're going? So I'm at this point now. I can't do nothing. And this is just the denial before Jesus even got to the cross. Wow. So imagine all the emotions that's going through him before Jesus gets to the cross. Now imagine the magnitude of his emotions when Jesus is actually nailed to the cross. So now we got, think about it now. We're just talking about his denial. Now he's got to go through the fact that I stumbled, I denied him, and now Jesus is dead. And unlike all the times before, Jesus was there to what? Correct Peter. But now Jesus is dead. His mindset is what? Anybody hear that? Like Dr. Harley said, he probably lost hope. Why? Because where is the person who's going to restore him now? He done forgot all about what Jesus said. So he's in a place of defeat. Okay. That's where he is. All right. But Jesus, the same one who prophesied to Peter that you're going to stumble, had also prophesied to them what? That he was going to what? Be raised from the dead. Apostle, you were about to say something.
Yes, I was going to say, when you were talking about Peter, where he was in a moment, you can imagine Satan, the enemy of his soul, as an opportunist who initiated Peter's denial of Jesus in the beginning. Then he turns around and capitalizes on it as an opportunist. When the Bible talks about the accuser of the brother, because now I'm sure he's running past Peter's mind, running in Peter's mind, the things that Jesus said, and look, he don't want you no more. Look how bad that you, he said you was going to do this, but you told him, no, you wasn't going to do this. And you was real adamant about it. Now look at it. Now just imagine, look at the other brothers. They probably thinking the same thing about you. Look at them. They probably think the same thing to Jesus. So you might as well just go on. So the accuser of the brother was really, at this time, I can imagine as an opportunist, really taking advantage to try to seal this place of denial where Peter had found himself at.
Amen. 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 As we're talking about this, I want you to think of your life and your walk with Christ and how there have been moments, I mean, where you have made some bad decisions. But something had to happen to shake you out of that, okay? Something, someone had to come and what? Juggle your mind, shake you, and say, sister, brother, wait a minute. You cannot stay here. Someone, something. And that's what happened with Peter. The psalmist in Psalm 23 talks about Jesus, what? The Lord is our shepherd. He restores our soul. Peter's soul now is in all kind of disarray and disrepair. Because we said our soul is what? Our mind and our will and our emotion. So Peter now needs to be restored. Unfortunately, the other disciples can't restore him because Jesus told them all of them was going to stumble and run. So they couldn't help him either because they had stumbled. And even though they weren't as adamant as Peter, there was no one there amongst those disciples to help Peter alone. But thank God for the prophetic word that Jesus told them, I'm gonna die, but 3 days later, I'm gonna what? Arise up. And I'm coming back. And sure enough, there were some events that occurred. He rose from the dead. The women went back and told Peter them what the teacher said. And they met him in Galilee and some different places. They got to see the risen Savior. Turn to John chapter 21, verse 15 through 19 is the account of Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ. The good shepherd is taking time to restore Peter. He's restoring Peter. In John 21, 15 through 19, they're gone out. What I say, he went out fishing. Jesus met him by the waterside. And Jesus was on the shore with the fire lit, cooking some fish. And as they came ashore, they find Jesus on the shoreline, which means that in his risen estate, he was recognizable because he had not ascended into heaven yet. So Jesus was recognizable. Does someone have John 21, 15 through 19?
I have it.
Read this.
So when they had denied Jesus, says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said unto him, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said unto him, feed my lambs. He said to him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He said unto him, yeah, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He said unto him, feed my sheep. He said unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whether thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whether thou wouldest not. This by he's signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he has spoken this, he said unto him, follow me.
Amen. Are y'all seeing here? Jesus now is having a conversation with the very one who denied him. He didn't just brush him off. He comes now. He has a conversation with him. And of course, Peter is grieved because Jesus keeps asking him the same question over and over. Now he really feeling bad because he knew he had denied him. He knew what he had said. So he grieved in spirit because it's like, oh, master, you don't believe me when I say I love you. Wow. Now you see the depths and breadth because Peter is hurting now because he knows what he's done. But at the same time, Jesus is having a conversation with him. And in the conversation, Jesus is giving Peter an assignment, which lets you know that Jesus is saying, Peter, I forgive you. I'm giving you an assignment. Wow. He's comforting him while entrusting him with an assignment. Are y'all seeing this? Are you really seeing this? Somebody spoke?
It sounds like Jesus is restoring Peter.
Yes, he's saying yes. So when you look at this, he's saying the thoughts, Jesus' thoughts towards Peter are what? Of good, not of evil, to bring him to an expected end. Are y'all seeing this? Yeah, you denied me, but I told you you was going to do this. I'm not holding it against you. I already knew you was going to do it, but I've got purpose for you. I already knew you was going to make an error, but I got purpose for you, okay? I knew you was going to say something or do something stupid, but I love you and I got purpose for you, and my purpose for you shall be fulfilled, okay? So let me get you back to where you need to be. Because you may thought you have lost your position, but you didn't lose your position with me. I forgive you. I need you to accept the assignment and forgive yourself. Okay? Can anyone say, show me or say to me or describe to me in what way does this conversation also show the Lord's faith, notice this, in Peter?
Dr. Kern.
Yeah.
So a couple of things. So now in Mark chapter 16 is the beginning in terms of Peter's restoration.
Uh-huh.
What I mean by that is when Mary was at the tomb and they saw the angel, the angel told them, said, now go tell his disciples and Peter.
And Peter.
So it's how Peter ended up with the rest of the disciples in this, in John.
Mm-hmm.
So what I find amazing is that when you look at the depth of Jesus' redemption for Peter, when Jesus asked him three times, it was three times to recover or redeem him from the three times he denied him. So it was the redemptive work to restore him over, to cross him over from those three times of denial into three times accepting the call of God. And the other thing was very interesting is now Peter was half right when he said, I'm not going to deny you, but the other part said, I'm going to die with you. So Jesus confirmed it in this conversation and said, yep, you will.
Amen. Are y'all getting this? Are y'all seeing this? Can you see yourself in this? Can you see yourself in this? Whether it's now or even when you came to Christ and you did not even think that you was what worthy because of all the mess that you had done. And even once you started walking with Christ, you made some mistakes along the way and felt like giving up. But you need to understand you're not the first one who's done something. But God has so much, I'm using this word, faith in you. He's still giving you an assignment to do. Wow. He trusts you to do the work. We talk about having faith in God. But have you ever thought that God also has faith in you? Faith in you to forgive yourself and faith in you to cross over and move forward and not stay stuck or go back to your old life. I want you to think about something in the days to come. We don't have to talk about it tonight, but think about this. what assignment has Jesus given you, which demonstrates to you his faith in you and his belief that you're going to be obedient to his word? Wow. What assignment has Jesus given you, which demonstrates to you his faith in you and that you're going to obey him? Because Jesus told him to do all of these things. He gave Peter a command. And he gave it to him knowing that Peter was going to obey him. Wow. God has given you an assignment regardless of what you've done, believing that you're going to do the assignment because you love him and you're willing to obey him. Okay, we got a few more minutes. Okay, so now, Peter, after all of this is over, we go into the book of Acts. And in the book of Acts, before Jesus ascended into heaven, he told them what? Tarry and wait for what? The Holy Spirit to receive power so that you can be witnesses. And Peter was one of the ones in the upper room. He stayed and remained. And we know the account of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they received the Holy Spirit. They began to speak with other tongues. Okay. And this occurred on the day of Pentecost. Okay. And people who witnessed it from the outside, who heard them speaking with other tongues, accused Peter and all of those in the upper room of being drunk. But Peter was able to get up and boldly stand. He denied their accusations of drunkenness. He began to proclaim the way of salvation, even after he had denied Jesus because he had been what? Restored. So Jesus forgave and restored Peter. Peter prayed. He accepted his forgiveness, okay? He accepted his restoration. He obeyed Jesus by tarrying in Jerusalem for power and the Holy Ghost. And then Peter was able to cross over. Are y'all seeing this? He was able to move forward and go and do his assignment. Turn to into Acts chapter 2. Turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, would someone read Acts chapter 2, verses 13 through 15?
I have it.
Okay.
Others mocking said, "They are full of new wine." But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. For these are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day."
Okay. Peter crossed over. He moved forward. He crossed over, in other words, from that place that he was in. He accepted his restoration and he was able to what? Move forward. But he could not move forward until he received the forgiveness of Jesus, but he also had to in order to move forward, he also had to have something else. He had to have the Holy Spirit to help him in his assignment. If you've noticed, I think in one of our previous lessons on crossing over and moving forward, there was some discussion about character and the need for certain characteristics that you have to have. Well, one of the things you have to have is a spirit of forgiveness, not only for other people, but even for yourself. Christ's forgiveness and forgiving yourself is an important attitude to move forward in our eternal journey. When you get a chance, read Ephesians 4:32, which tells us be kind and loving to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgives you. Listen. Sometimes I watch us today as we are quick to make assumptions when someone has made a bad decision. Why? And want to cast them aside as if they're no longer fit for the kingdom. I think Apostle said the other week, be careful what you put your mouth on. Because Jesus is the restorer. And not only will Jesus restore them, but you also have to be careful that you don't get yourself into a position where you have to be restored because you have made an error or you've denied Jesus in some kind of way. I want you to think about this account of Peter that we've just been discussing. How does us looking at Peter and what happened with Peter, how will this help you to go forward in spite of? Anybody, how does this help you to go forward in, notice what I said, in spite of, and I'm not putting whatever is there. How does this help you? Yes.
Yes. Well, you know, hearing that and, you know, even some things that's been going on is helping me to give others more grace as God has given me. And I see grace now, you know, as a thing that we as Christians, sometimes we don't have it like we need to have it. But in these times, I believe we need to know how to give people more grace than we do get them originally.
Okay. And give yourself what? Grace.
Grace, yes.
Not only give it to others, but give yourself a level of what? Grace to move what? To move forward. Anyone else? How does this help you in your journey? Come on.
I think it confirms and is an encouragement to us when, especially when the enemy tries to give us the impression that that we're whatever way we have fallen short, that God has just tossed us aside as well. It's an assurance, a reaffirmation that that just as Christ forgave Peter for denial, he will forgive us too. So we have to kind of keep that in mind, and the same way for others, that the same grace that he gave us is the same he extends to them. And I agree with Evangelist Terry that, you know, we just have to be mindful of that when we might not have fallen short, but it might be someone else, or vice versa when we had, that we don't have to walk away, that we don't have to, as the Lord spoke on Sunday, we don't have to quit just because we fell short, but we can feel built up that Christ still loves us, and what he said is still what he said, and he is still expecting us and looking for us with open arms to come back into the fold and to take the place that he had already ordained for us.
Anyone else?
I was thinking when you had asked us, what do we think about after doing Peter did what he did, how he was going to be received? What helps me to go on is to know that Jesus' love and forgiveness is enough. Not necessarily we have to be defined by what other people feel about us, or what other people think about us. Just to know Jesus' love is enough. Jesus' faith in us is enough, because I remember the scripture says his prayer was that our faith fail us not. So to know that Jesus' love for us is enough, that's what keeps me going, no matter what others may say.
Okay. Anyone else? How does this account of Peter help you to go forward in spite of? Or how will it help you to go forward in spite of?
Anyone it gives else? Me, it encourages me, and it gives me new hope to keep going forward. That just because when you fell, that don't mean you have to stay there.
Okay. Anyone else?
I was thinking about the scripture that said there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. So going forward, if I was to stumble, and when I begin to condemn myself, I would have to be reminded of what the scripture says in Romans 8, I think it's 8:1. And it says, if you walk after the flesh, know not to walk after my flesh, get out of myself, get out of my flesh, and walk, get back into the spirit, because there is no condemnation in Jesus. And we sit in a place of condemnation for a while, and that's where the enemy is going to continue to beat us up. But we have to remember, I would have to remember, that there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. Get back on the horse, get up, and move forward into the things that God has, because restoration is in Christ. It's not in me. It's not in me wallowing. It's not in me giving up. Restoration is always, and reconciliation is always available in Christ Jesus.
Okay. Also, did not Peter have to have a posture of having a renewed mind? He had to have a posture of having a renewed mind, which means he could not be so dogmatic that he would not receive restoration. So he had to renew his what? His mind. Remember, we were talking about all of those thoughts that were going through him and through his mind, his emotions and his will and everything, how negative it was before Jesus came in and restored him. You also have to have a mind to receive the restoration. We have Holy Spirit now, who is our helper, who is our comforter, who's our teacher, who brings things back to memory. But if you don't want to remember, and if you want to wallow there, now that's a warfare that you now are creating, because you are not willing to renew your mind when the Lord comes to help you.
Prophet, so, I see that also as us having to now deny our flesh.
Yes.
We have to deny our flesh, our emotions, and the will, the desire to comfort ourselves in the wallow and get up and put off the works of the flesh and move forward.
We definitely have to have a renewed mind and put off the work of the flesh, but you also have to do this. You cannot care more about what man says than what Jesus said. Jesus gave Peter an assignment. Remember, we said, he was also maybe concerned with what people was going to say about him. He now had to lay that aside and face them and face anything that was said, because now he's been restored. And now you've got to have a mope. That's why I say he boldly got up and said, no, we're not drunk. Let me tell you what this is about. And that's when he preached his first sermon. This is what the prophet Joel talked about. He got up and boldly began to say, listen, this is what this is about. and he had to ignore what their faces. He had to ignore what may have been said about him or what could be said. And that's the way you, some of us, when people begin to tell us who we used to be or when we go back home, we're no longer that person. We have been transformed. And we've got to have that boldness to firmly stand and declare what the Lord is saying and not allow what people say or our past, whatever, past decision, keep us in a place where God has pulled us out from.
Yeah.
That's all I have for the night. If anyone has any other comments before I turn it over to Apostle, thank you all for participating this week. As the Lord will and tarry, I can tell you all now, we're going to talk about Saul next week. Let's talk about Saul. And think about, as when I give you these scriptures, look how bad Saul was. Saul was so bad. He killed people. He persecuted people. But God still used him. And he also now has to make a decision what? To cross over and move forward. Because crossing over and moving forward requires us to make an individual decision. Anyone else?
Prophet Kern. Mm-hmm. I was wondering, like, when we put ourselves in Peter's situation, when I think we all have been in there at some point, I think also it was teaching us how we are to be able to restore one another. You know, Jesus was the example, and he was showing us too that when we see one another who's in that state maybe of guilt, shame, depression, whatever it is, that we can be able to have to restore them, because we know that what God brought us out of, then we could turn around and restore our sisters and brothers, right?
That's scriptural, yes. We ought to, when we serve one another in the fault, we are to what? Restore one another. Yes. That's, again, is that grace. That's having grace for other people and grace for ourselves.
Yeah. Yes.
Apostle, I'm done. I turn it over to you. I know it was a lot, but and a lot for all of you all, but I hope it's enough, you know, a lot for you all to think about and give some consideration as you go about this week, as we go forward in Christ, crossing over to do bigger and greater things, not only in the church, but in our lives. God bless you. Apostle Thompson, I turn it over to you.
Amen. Praise God. Can we give God praise for the class tonight and for Dr. McCray? Great class tonight. Great class tonight. there's so many points that can be gleaned out of the lesson tonight. And one of the points when she talked about accepting, because none of what Jesus would have said to Peter would have mattered if Peter did not accept it. The Bible says that we've been given the word and ministry of reconciliation. And I think as Minister Bell said, Jesus told Peter, says, then when you're converted, go and strengthen your brother. That same grace, the same word and ministry of reconciliation works both ways. It is the word and ministry of reconciliation that we have to extend to ourselves and receive, as well as to others, so that we don't hold them in. And what's so amazing, the lesson tonight actually, when it talks about Peter, shows this aspect of crossover, how crossover applies to everything. So literally what we're talking about when we talk about crossover, we're not talking about a one-time thing, because we know the word crossover means moving from one place to another. But Romans 12 and 2 says that as believers, we ought to live the crossover life. He says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. that you will prove what is that good and perfect and acceptable will of God. So even when we talk about crossover, it does not always mean sin, but it can sometimes become sin whenever God says to for us to do something, or there's a preceding word of the Lord, and we refuse to walk in that, then it can become sin, because we are not doing what God's told us to do. So we're actually, in essence, talking about living a crossover life. Hallelujah. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away, all things have become new. While that is a truth, that is a positional truth, but yet it is a progressive walk for manifestation. And that's why we have to live this crossover life, because every time we cross over into this, our minds being renewed, what happens is it's not new to God, but what's happening is there's a degree of I don't want to say unity, but oneness. In other words, when Jesus told him to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." So every time we receive that word, so when Peter received what Jesus said, that restoration, that redemption, and that restoration, then what was done in heaven became manifested in the earth in Peter. And I think this is something that we all as believers have to always keep in mind when we talk about the word and ministry of reconciliation, because repentance and forgiveness are points or portals or doorways or gates for the word and ministry of reconciliation, and not to hold people to things. Especially because we don't know the whole story. We only see a snapshot. God knew when he told Peter that Acts 2 was coming. And he did not want to lose that inheritance because of a moment. So great class tonight. Thank you again to Dr. Kern and to everybody that participated. And so as we get ready to take our leave, have a great rest of the night. I pray that the Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And I pray and decree over us all that the crossover life, the power of Jesus to restore, not only works in us mightily to keep us going from faith to faith and from glory to glory, but that, as he said to Peter, we go and do likewise to our brother. Have a great night. Love you all with our life, and look to see everyone. I look to talk to everyone on this coming Thursday for prayer. Have a great night.
Great class. Good night, everybody. See?